So this is a story of my perilous sailing journey with my boyfriend on Oneida Lake. 2 years ago, I decided that I wanted to go down to Sylvan Beach from Maple Bay, where my boat was. And that was 11 miles from the marina that I kept my boat at to Sylvan Beach. And it was a very calm day. And we started off basically hardly having any wind.
Video.
I'm on YouTube.
Oh no.
And it was going with us down to Sylvan Beach, which is quite typical, but I thought it was going to be some more wind. And the weather report was only saying 40% chance of rain. And I thought, well, that's not a big deal. I mean, it's probably just a little rainstorm. I don't have to really worry about it too much. And I thought I'd take the chance. So we decided we would go down and we were going to watch the fireworks at Sylvan Beach, which they have every year on July 6th. We got down there just in time and the sun was going down. All of a sudden, we see the storm coming off from the west, which is how the storms come for us, is usually from the west. And there was this big crash of lightning. It was a purple, like, lightning strike in the middle of the water. And you saw all these boats scrambling to get away from it. And it turned out to be a really bad storm. There's a marina entrance into the Sylvan Beach marina area. And I've never been there. It's like a little canal. And there's a jetty that comes out, and it's like a rock jetty. And all of a sudden, we saw this cop. I didn't even know it was a cop because it didn't say it was police. And he was going around telling all the people to get back in the boat. And we're thinking, oh, well, why would he be doing that? Maybe they just don't want people in the water at night because they were in the water, like, swimming. And the police, but they didn't come over to us. We didn't know what was going on. And I was cooking pasta in a pot out in the cockpit. And I had it on butane stove. And it was going, and it was done by then. And then the storm hit, and we were anchored. And everybody had gone, and you could see them all going into that part, and we're thinking, oh, I'll just wait until it's over, it'll be okay. And then the wind hit, and it was crazy. It was like we retreated to the cabin. I closed up the boat, she was anchored, and I started to drag anchor. But we waited until the storm was pretty much done, and it was a really strong wave. I don't know how high it was at that time, and I think a lot of people think that you can easily overestimate waves, and I think that's probably true. And I would say they were like only like 3 feet at the time. But when you're in a 20-foot boat, 3 feet is like crazy. It's a lot of wave for a little boat. And so we were inside. The boat was like going like this, and we were inside the boat, and that's what it felt like. It was like we were in a washing machine, and I said, don't worry about this. It's going to be okay. You know, I know that this boat is designed for this. It can tip over. It can lean really a lot because it's got a keel. And that's what it's designed to do. And so I really didn't think anything. I would think, we're just going to weather this little bit. And then we'll go off and we'll be fine. I was planning on staying there for the night. I wasn't going to drive back. I thought we would just park at some place and we'd have a nice night. The major part of the storm did pass. But the wind and the waves didn't pass. And it continued all night long and all the next day. And the wind was still coming from the west. And this lake is a west-east running lake. And so it has time when the wind is coming from one direction. It can go down the entire lake. And it's a really big lake. It's probably, my guess is 20 miles long. So the wind has time to build the waves all that distance. Even though it's a shallow lake, I mean, the deepest it is like 50 feet. So that's not a whole lot, but it doesn't matter because it's still building those waves. So I decided I was going to try to, like, get the boat into the marina, into the port there in Sylvan Beach. And I came around the corner, and there was a, like the light at the end of the jetty. And I thought it was, like, the end of the jetty, and I'm trying to get around it, and I hit the rocks. And nothing happened to the boat. Thank God, because this is an old boat. It's strong. It has really thick fiberglass. So nothing happened to the boat, but we had to push ourselves off with the paddles. And then I was able to motor backwards and get out of it. So I never got in, and I thought, well, I'll go over to this other side and we'll weather the storm there. And I thought I was far enough away from shore because it's this whole time the wind is pushing us into the shore, and it's pushing us and pushing. And so I'm dragging anchor. So you can't sleep. When you're dragging anchor, you know your boat is moving. The last thing you want to do is sleep because you know you're going to end up on the beach. My boat was going to get wrecked. And so I was like, okay, if we have to motor out of it and then back, and I'll do it. But all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, I caught on something. And we stopped moving. We stopped dragging anchor. And I thought, well, okay, we'll just go to sleep then. And so we went to sleep. And, well, we didn't actually go to sleep. I couldn't sleep. You can't sleep all night when the boat is acting like a washing machine in it. Well, after we had laid down to sleep, we had left the hatch open, which is over the, like, the front deck, and which is where the V berth is, where we were sleeping. And we're trying to sleep, and we're not able to because the boat is moving so much. And then the water, like a wave, splashed up and went into the hatch. And basically, like, splashes. We're, like, trying to sleep, and all of a sudden we're, like, splash. We're, like, oh, my God. So I had to get up and shut the hatch. And then I also realized that the sail was in the water, and it had popped out of its bag that I put it in and had dragged in the water. So I'm out there with the boat going like this over the waves, and I'm pulling this sail in, this waterlogged sail in, which is when you start pulling something that's, it's like a parachute in the water. It's very hard to kind of, and then when you finally get it, it's easier, but there's a point where it's like holding that wave energy, and so it's really difficult to pull out. I got that out, got that back in the bag, tied that down really good. And also the bow chock, where the anchor line went down into the water, I had a bow chock, and which is the thing that kind of keeps the anchor line from rubbing on the boat, causing damage. And the stress on that anchor line was so hard. This is while we were sleeping, or trying to sleep anyway. This loud pop came and basically took the anchor chock and ripped it off the boat. So it was really crazy. And then we decided that we were going to try to leave. There was the pasta that was still in the cockpit. I had brought that inside, and then I decided we were going to get the engine going. So I decided I would give him the task of pulling up the anchor. Now, at this time, people think that I was overestimating, but I really don't think so, because the waves were like 6 foot high. At least, I would say at least. And there was this, and I don't think I'm overestimating at all. There was this boat, like several boats that tried to come out of the marina, and a bass boat. I don't know what they were thinking, but they almost went, like the wind almost picked up their front and they almost went over. And then they had to go back in, and everybody that tried to come out went right back. And you know, they always say that they like to go fishing when it's a little choppy because the fish are better, but they couldn't even get out there. So everybody that we saw went back into the marina. No one came out there. We were in the little bay just anchored and the boat is going like this the whole time. And we're looking at them going, are they crazy? Why are they even trying to do this? So he had to go to work the next day. So we had to motor. I had to motor home, but I couldn't do it because, well, I could do it. But I had the problem that whenever I started the engine, it would start for a while and then it just died. And so then I was like, what is the problem here? And then I had realized that it actually, it's a two-stroke engine, a Mariner two-stroke, and all night long the engine is going like this, back and forth. And it basically broke the end off where the tube goes into the connector that connects to the engine. And so the fuel line was attached to this other piece that connects into the engine. And that snapped off. And there was no way I was going to go anywhere if I didn't find some way to modify that. So I went digging down inside the boat and I took Dramamine. My boyfriend had been sick all this time because he didn't take Dramamine. And I was basically overdosing on Dramamine. But it was the only way that I was going to be okay. So I was taking the Dramamine. I found, thank God I kept it, I found the old connector, the fuel connector that connects to the engine. And I found it and it was like leaking pretty bad. And so the engine would stall out because it was starved of fuel. And so I took that old connector and I put it on. And then I took a piece of duct tape and I basically made the seal good and was able to jury rig it so that it was continued to get fuel. So I kept the engine going. He's pulling up the anchor, or he's trying to, and he couldn't pull it up. And I'm thinking, what's going on here? Why isn't he able to get the anchor up? So I'm starting to drive the boat forward, and I'm thinking, okay, he's going to have it up by the time. So I got the engine going, and I'm trying to go forward a little bit. And he's not able to get it up, and he gets 3 feet up, and then he's like, what the hell? I'm like, okay, forget it. I'm just going to go try it. So I went up, and I decided I was going to pull it. And it was stuck. It was stuck on something, but he didn't know it. So it was stuck on the bottom on something. Later on, I found out that there was a barge sunk there in that very spot on the bottom. And so my thought was, is what had happened was the anchor caught on the sunken barge and basically saved us from hitting the shore all night long. And it was the only thing. So I couldn't get it off the bottom. And so I didn't know any better. And so I cut the line because I realized it's not good to be without an anchor, but I didn't have a choice. I had to cut the line. And I guess if I had thought about it, I should have like tied a fender to it. And then I could have went back to retrieve it. But turns out that boat is actually 20 feet underwater and I couldn't have dove for it probably anyway. So we start our journey westward, 11 miles. Remember, the waves are still like 6 feet. I think more. The waves were really high. I think I'm underestimating. I think they were more like 8 feet. But I'm trying to underestimate because I know that when you're in the water and you're looking at a wave, you're like, oh, this is huge. It's not a big deal when you're in the ocean and you have swells that are 6 feet. And you can have swells that are 10 feet and still be okay in the ocean. But the thing is that in a lake, like Lake Oneida, Cougar Lake, or any of the Finger Lakes, the waves build and they're so close together. They're about 5 feet apart. So they're 6 foot high and 5 feet apart. So they're really steep. I have a 9.9 engine on the back of my boat. So I am going through this and it is really difficult. I am going through the mess. It is these huge waves and we're going through it. Halfway there, we run out of fuel. And so then I had to fill it up again. So luckily I had another tank that had gas in it and I transferred that gas into that tank and was able to get the engine restarted. We had like 5 more miles to go or 6 more miles to go. And we come in and we're coming around into the Maple Bay. And then all of a sudden the engine dies. And we're coming around the corner and the waves at this point had switched direction so that they were going from like northwest to southeast. It was kind of angling and I had to really come around the corner. The engine died. I couldn't get the engine started again. So I start to go, oh my God, what am I going to do? And my boyfriend had like hypothermia at the time. And I have this North Face jacket, which is probably the thing that saved my life because, and the duct tape that I used to jury rig the fuel line. And my boyfriend is freezing. You can tell his lips are purple. He's shaking uncontrollably. And I said, go down below. And so he was down below for a little while. But then I was like, I have to have him help me paddle to get into the marina. Then all of a sudden, I realized that the waves were enough behind me. And when you're driving a sailboat and you have momentum and you're moving, then you can steer with a rudder. So I didn't need to paddle in and I didn't need his help paddling because we didn't have to paddle at all because I was moving fast enough with the waves. And the waves literally pushed me right into my berth. It was completely calm in there because it's very protected from the winds with all the trees around it. So we got into the berth, we tied off, and we slept for 2 hours. And we were just so exhausted. During the entire trip there, the waves were splashing every so often. It was coming over. And so it was like, we would go over a wave and they were splashing. And then over another wave and we were splashing. So that's why we got soaked and we got cold. But then the sun was coming out a little bit. And we were thinking, oh, the sun, ooh, it'll warm us up. And we came back with the worst burns. We had horrible like sunburns on our face, but we didn't feel it because we were so cold and the wind was so strong and going right through us. And he didn't have a coat. And I had my North Face coat that was, I'm so glad I had it. And I was a little gun shy about going out on that lake after that incident. It was like the first time I decided to go on a real journey someplace. That one time I chose to go on a journey was the one where there's a horrible storm that I've got to try to get out of. So I think a lot of ocean sailors could probably understand exactly where I'm coming from, but it's easy to be a little gun shy when you have a really bad experience. But I'm grateful that everything came out okay. I didn't really sustain any damage to my boat. I think my engine died after that, though, and I got it repaired. But basically, that was about it. We think the winds were about 25 knots. That's the data that we got from a friend who works as a rescuer on that lake. And he said that that was the worst night. I think the people that I told about this story were really surprised about what had happened. But we're really lucky, and I'm glad we made it okay.